about your God, and my God is awesome. Amen. He's Jehovah Jireh, my provider. He's Jehovah Sikkenu. He's Jehovah Nisi. He is an awesome God. Amen. Amen. So we're so thankful and so honored. Amen. To serve a true and a living God. Amen. Those of you who have your Bibles today, I want to turn to Jeremiah chapter 1. The Gospel according to Jeremiah. And we will be reading from verses 1, amen, through 18. Josh, let's pick it up at verse 4. Amen. That would be a little lengthy reading. So we're going to pick it up at verse 4. I told Brother Josh verse 1, but I'm going to start at verse 4. Amen. All right. And it reads as thus. I'll be reading from the New American Standard Bible. Amen. And it says, now the word of the Lord came to me saying, behold, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I have appointed you a prophet to the nations. Then I said, alas, Lord God, behold, I do not know how to speak because I am a youth. But the Lord said to me, do not say I am a youth, because everywhere I send you, you shall go, and all that I command you, you shall speak. Do not be afraid of them. For I am with you to deliver you, declares the Lord. Then the Lord stretched out his hand and he touched my mouth. And the Lord said to me, behold, I have put my words in your mouth. See, I have appointed you this day over the nations and over the kingdoms, to pluck up and to break down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant. The word of the Lord came to me saying, what do you see, Jeremiah? And I said, I see a rod of an almond tree. Then the Lord said to me, you have seen well, for I am watching, lost my spot, over my word to perform it. The word of the Lord came to me a second time, saying, what do you see? And I said, I see a boiling pot facing away from the north. Then the Lord said to me, out of thy mouth, out of the north, the evil will break forth, and all the inhabitants of the land. For behold, I am calling all the families of the kingdoms of the north, declares the Lord, and they will come, and they will set each one of his thrones at the entrance of the gates of Jerusalem, and against all its walls round about, and against all the cities of Judah, I will pronounce my judgments on them concerning all their wickedness, whereby they have forsaken me and have offered sacrifice to other gods, and worship the works of their hands. Now, gird up your loins and arise and speak to them all which I command you. Do not be dismayed before them, or I will dismay you before them. Final verse. Now before I have made you today as a fortified city and as a pillar of iron and as a walls of bronze against the whole land, to the kings of Judah, to its princes, to its priests, and to the people of the land. Verse number 19. They will fight against you, but they will not overcome you. For I am with you to deliver you, declares the Lord. And the people of God said, amen. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We like to think from a thought today, this morning, encountering a God that loves you. Encountering a God that not only loves you, he believes in you. Encountering a God who believes in you. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we stretch forth our hands unto the hills from whence cometh our help. We understand and realize our help only comes from the Lord. Father, we thank you for saturating this place with song, with dance, with scripture, and with prayer. But now, God, it comes time for us to sit at the feet of the Word of God. Father, we declare that we must open up our eyes and ears to hear what the Spirit has to say to the church. Oh, God, we pray that the man you give decrease, as the Holy Spirit may increase, that you would speak a word that would cause young men, boys, and girls to fall out of love with the world, to fall in love with Jesus. Father, we know that there can be no preaching done until the preacher comes. Thou art the potter, we are the clay. Speak through us. Use us for your service. And it is in Jesus' name we pray. And we say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Jeremiah, this text, Jeremiah received from God a clear and unique calling, what we will call the Jeremiah experience. This Jeremiah experience becomes the foundation for his life, his ministry, and his destiny. Jeremiah states 10 factors in which Jeremiah experiences. These factors can be applied to every person because every person is in desperate need of a Jeremiah experience. God has set in motion his plan for every person. And each one has a unique calling, life, ministry, and destiny. However, there is a spirit of this generation that affects every person, every Christian, and every non-Christian that seeks to undermine the destiny and the call of God, which he has planned upon our lives. We must have in the church a Jeremiah experience so we can be a message to this generation. Let's take a look at some people who have encountered the God who believes in them. Many of us are always looking for inspiration. Many of us are always looking for encouragement. But I encourage you today that God, who believes in you,
will be your greatest rooting section. He will become your greatest fan. He will become your greatest supporter if you would just trust in the Lord. My brother Jacob, in Genesis chapter 28, verses 10 through 15, recognizes that God believes in him. He says in Genesis 28, "My God Almighty bless you and make you fruitful and multiply, you that you may be an assembly of people and give you the blessings of Abraham. To you and your descendants with you, that you might inherit the land in which you are a stranger, which God gave to Abraham." In this scripture text, Jacob is promised five things. I declare, as you walk with God, as you get to know him and you are in relationship, these five promises are also made to you. The first thing in the text we see that Jacob is promised, "I will give you." God promises him that "I will give you, Jacob, the things that you desire, the things that you have longed for." Jesus declares in the same text that not only will I give you, he said, "You shall inherit." God is simply telling Jacob that you will inherit things that you don't even deserve. Amen. You are a joint heir to the throne of Abraham, and you will inherit, amen, the things and the promises of God. The third thing he tells him in that particular text, he said, "You shall spread abroad." I will expand your territory. A God is a God of promise. He tells Jacob, the fourth thing you will receive, he said, "Not only will I give you and you shall inherit and you shall spread abroad," he also says, Jacob, "that I will keep you." All to be kept by the hand of God. I don't know about you, amen, but when I'm in God's hands, everything's going to be all right. He declares in that same text, the fifth promise, he says, "Not only will I keep you," he says, "Jacob, I'm never going to leave you." The word of God says, "I've never seen the righteous forsaken or seed begging bread." God says that if you remain in righteousness, if you remain in relationship with God, I will never leave you. Can I get another witness? If Joseph was here, Joseph would declare in Genesis chapter 37, verses 5 through 7, he would say these words. Now, Joseph had a dream, and he had told it to his brothers, and they hated him even more. So Joseph said, he said to them, "Please hear this dream, which I have dreamed. There we were binding sheaves in the field. Then behold, my sheaves arose and also stood upright. And indeed, your sheaves stood all around and bowed down to my sheaves." His brothers became dismayed and disheartened, thought that Joseph was bragging about himself. But Joseph was delivering the word of God. Then you run around down to about Genesis 50, verse 20. Joseph concludes the thought process. He says, "But as for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, in order to bring it about as it is this day, to save many people. This must come to pass." Joseph concludes in between chapter 37 and verse 50 the story of Joseph, where his brothers bound him and tried to have him killed. But Joseph concludes that even what I've gone through, even what I've had to deal with against my family, even what has come to destroy me, cannot take me out. Why? Because I am the child of the king. In the text, we find four things that Joseph clarifies. Joseph clarifies that his family had ostracized him, that his father had doubted his relationship with God, that his mother didn't believe Joseph was the called out one. And not only that, he believed and he had saw that his brothers had mocked his ministry, had mocked his prophesying. But all of that didn't matter because Jesus said in the fourth point, but God believed me. Believed in him. Trusted in him. Believed that Joseph was a child of the king. Not only did God believe in Joseph, God believed in Joshua. In Joshua 1 and 8, it says, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in the day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Joshua was told three things by God in the text. He declares that if you would stay in the will of God, he said, you will have success. I stopped by to tell you today, y'all, that success is within your reach. A success is within your power. And the second thing he tells Joshua in 1:8, he said, you will do it. You will accomplish that in which I've called you to do. Amen. Don't allow circumstances. Don't allow your situation. Don't allow the lack of money and food to separate you from the things of God. Because if you stay in the will of God, you will be successful. Then the third thing he declares in this Joshua 1 and 8, Jesus says that when you do the first two, people will follow you. I had to resonate there for a minute, y'all, because we understand that even New Covenant is going through a roller coaster ride. And amen, and I don't know about you, but when I'm on a roller coaster, amen, there is certain things in a roller coaster that causes me stress. There's certain things in a roller coaster that causes my nerves to tensing up. All right. Amen. And you might know what you might think I'm having a good time on the outside. But on the inside, amen, the roller coaster is tossing me to and fro. Amen. From the moment I get in the roller coaster and they bring down the lock-in bar, I don't have a lot of faith in the lock-in bar. When you're 5'10" and you're 260 pounds, I don't have a whole lot of faith in the lock-in bar. And as the roller coaster goes loop-de-loo, and the roller coaster goes loop-de-la, my inside is being turned inside out. But sometimes life can be like a roller coaster. Sometimes up, and sometimes down, and sometimes almost level to the ground. But I've learned to trust in Jesus, and I've learned to trust in God. What Joshua is saying, what Joshua has found out, that God believes in him. What are you saying to me today, Pastor? I'm telling you that God is the same God yesterday, today, and tomorrow, and forevermore. What he's done for Joshua, God will do for you. What God has did for just Joseph, God will do for you. And what God has did for Jacob, God will also do for you. I hear some women from the pew saying, well, God just is not just a good God to men. He's a good God to women. You're so right today. Because God believed in Esther. And in Esther 4:14, you'll find these words. For if you remain completely silent at this time, relief and deliverance will rise up for the Jews from another place. But you and your father's house will perish. Yet who knows whether you have come to the kingdom for such a time as this. As God believed in Esther, he believed that she would hold on. Number one, not of the Lord. When you do things that are not of God. And number two, he decreased but will become a royalty. What I'm telling you today, sometimes you gotta decrease that the Lord may increase. Y'all don't hear me. Sometimes in God, you gotta take two steps back in yourself that you might be able to take one step forward in God. God is a good God, and he's a great God. He can do anything but fail. Y'all don't hear me. If Jabez was here to witness today, he'd say something like 1 Chronicles 4:10. And Jabez called on God, the God of Israel, saying, oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory, that your hand would be with me, and that you would keep evil from me, that I may not cause pain. So God granted him what he had requested. Y'all don't hear me. In 1 Chronicles 4:10, Jabez began to speak to God, and he began to declare the word of God. Y'all don't hear me. Jabez had nothing to believe in about himself, but he believed that through Christ, who strengthened me, all things are possible for them that believe. Y'all don't hear me. I feel like preaching today. Jabez, he chose to live beyond his pain. Jabez chose to live beyond his disappointment. Oh, Jabez, he decided to live beyond his faults and walk into his needs. Y'all don't hear me. I stopped by to tell you today that we serve a God who believes in us. Y'all don't hear me. As we begin to look at the text in Jeremiah chapter 1, verses 1 through 18, we begin to see the Jeremiah experience. Y'all don't hear me. It's the Jeremiah experience that will bring you to your knees. It's a Jeremiah experience that will cause you to fall out of love with the world and fall in love with Jesus. The foundation for life is in the Jeremiah experience. Jeremiah was a young man, and also in the Jeremiah experience, you'll find the foundational for ministry. He was just beginning as a young man. Y'all don't hear me. In the Jeremiah experience, you will also find the foundation for destiny. He doubted his great destiny. Y'all don't hear me. Jeremiah thought about his own insufficiencies. He said, now I'm a young boy, and I don't know a whole lot. But Jesus touched his lips, and he said, I have put my word in your mouth. Y'all don't hear me. Jeremiah missed the 10 points in the text of Jeremiah. There's 10 points that God convinced Jeremiah of. The first thing he told Jeremiah is, Jeremiah, you were predestined for what's about to happen in your life. Don't you see it in the text? In Jeremiah, verse 1, chapter 1, verse 5, look what he tells Jeremiah. He says, before I formed you, in your mother's womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I sanctified you. And before you were born, I ordained you as a prophet to all the nations. I don't know about you. If that was not predestination, I don't know what predestination means. Jesus looked at Jeremiah. He said, there's a purpose for your life. The Hebrew word formed means simply to shape as a potter does with the clay in creation of Adam. Y'all don't hear me. Before you was a twinkle in your mama's eye, he told Jeremiah, I knew you. He told Jeremiah that I sanctified you. He told Jeremiah that I fought, that I ordained you. Y'all don't hear me. The second thing in that verse number 5, he told Jeremiah, this factor that he gave Jeremiah needed assurance. And the assurance is that it formed you. His unshakable conviction that his mission was definitely ordained by God. Y'all don't hear me. God has called you out of the darkness into his marvelous light. Y'all don't hear me. When I was a wretch undone, tore up from the floor, God stepped out of heaven, transform me. And I gotta tell you, places I used to go, don't go there no more. Things I used to do, don't do the things no more. Since Jesus came in to the line, I looked down at my hands, they were brand new. Looked down at my feet, they look brand new too. Since Jesus has came in to my life, what am I saying, new covenant? I know sometimes we look like there's trouble. It looks like trouble on the left, looks like trouble on the right, look like trouble behind us, and look like trouble before us. But I don't know about you. When trouble comes, I stretch out my rod and part my Red Sea. Because Jesus is Jehovah Jireh, a way out of no way. He is bridge over troubled waters. He's a bright and morning star. Y'all don't hear me. This is a preaching message. I want you to know that in the 10 things that God will do for you, the second thing God will do, that he told Jeremiah in the text, you are set apart, you are set aside, you were made for a purpose, to honor God. Don't you see in verse 5, he makes the verse say, before I formed you in your mother's womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I sanctified you. I ordained you a prophet before all the nations. Look what Jesus is saying. Jesus has called you, and he's called me to be set apart by God. There was nothing by happenstance about the life and the process of Jeremiah. God had formulated each step in his life. And I want you to know that God has designed every step in your life. Somebody said, I've learned to trust in Jesus. Somebody got to say, I've learned to trust in God when there's no way. I serve a God who has set me apart to make a way out of no way. I know that God is a good God, and he'll be with me even until the end of the earth. Y'all don't hear me. I've been set aside. I've been bought with a price. Jesus came that I might have a right to the tree of life. The third thing in the text, in verse number 5, we see that you are appointed. You are designed for the purpose of God. He lets Jeremiah know that if I'm with you, I'm more than the world will get you. He said, before you were formed in the womb, I knew you. He said, before you were born, I was sanctified and ordained you as a prophet. The word ordained in the Hebrew means to give, to put, and to set. Y'all don't hear me. God is giving you all that you need, and God will put you where you need to be. And God has set the foundation of the world beneath your feet. God is a good God, and he'll never leave you or forsake you. God is appointed time. There's an appointed time to live, and there's an appointed time to die. But God told young Jeremiah that I have set in order before the foundation of the world, before you was a twinkle in your mother's eye, I have prepared the way of the Lord for you. But look what he says in Jeremiah, verses 6 and 7. We find out that young Jeremiah becomes qualified. I stopped by to tell you today that Jesus died and rose again with all power of heaven and earth in his hands. You are qualified. You are bought with a price. Look what he says to Brother Jeremiah. Then he said, I, Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I am a youth. But look what the Lord said. But the Lord said to me, do not say, I am a youth, for you shall go to all of whom I send you, and whatever I command you, you shall see. Y'all don't hear me. The word young in the Hebrew means too young. He was about 20 years of age. He was a man according to the law. He had reached manhood. So God told him, y'all don't hear me, don't make no excuses. Just trust in the Lord with all your heart, with all my mind, and all my soul, and lean not to your own understanding. And even in your illness, follow me, and I will direct your path. not to be intimidated by the things of this world, because you are qualified. You are saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost. Y'all don't hear me? And not only that, when God calls you to something, he wanted Jeremiah to know that he was not only qualified, but he was also anointed. Look at verse 8. Jesus says, do not be afraid of their faces, for I am with you to deliver you, said the Lord. I don't know about you, but that's good news. And not only is it good news, it's great news, because Jesus said, I am with you even until the end of the earth. And no weapon, Romans said, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. I'm glad today that God is a good God, and he is a supporting God. And he says in Psalm 23 that the Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. God has anointed you to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. He said some are called to preach, some are called to teach, some are called to evangelism, some are called to prophesy in the name of the Lord. But you are anointed and appointed for the task that God has called you to. The sixth thing is, you are touched. You are touched by the Lord. Look what he says in Jeremiah 1:9. Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said to me, behold, I have put my words in your mouth. That's powerful to me. The word of the Lord has come to my mouth, and now I must apply it to my life. Look at Jeremiah. He received everything that he needed from the Lord. I'm glad today that one glad morning I was singing deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, but the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. I've been touched by the Lord, and I'm no longer the same. I'm glad I don't walk like I used to walk. I don't talk like I used to talk. I'm glad that God touched me. He picked me up, turned me around, placed my feet on solid ground. Y'all don't hear me? I'm glad that God is with me and that he has anointed me to preach the gospel. Look what Jeremiah says in verse number 10. He said this, I have this day sent you over the nations and have over the kingdoms to root out and to pull up, to destroy and to throw down, to build up and to plant. The seventh thing he's telling Jeremiah is you are on a mission. Y'all didn't hear me? God called you that you might be on a mission for him. Just like Jeremiah, he called to an almost impossible mission. He's calling us to save a nation back to the only true God. Paganism had taken over Israel, and they were in a state of religious apostasy, and the morals had decayed. Sound like Indianapolis? yeah, to me, folk have turned from God, doing all kind of things. We are living in some terrible times, but God has called us to the mission. The mission to clothe those that are naked, to feed those that are hungry, to save those that are lost. You are on a mission. Look at Jeremiah. As we get close to a close, look at Jeremiah 1:18. For behold, I made this day a forbidden city, and an iron pillar and bronze walls against the whole land and against the kings of Judah, against its princes and against its priests and against the people of the land. Which brings me to point number 8. You are protected. You are protected. You have divine protection, and the enemy cannot penetrate what 23 said, that goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life as I dwell in the house of the Lord. Jeremiah was promised protection as long as he stayed on God's side. Whose side are you leaning on? Whose side are you leaning on? I'm leaning on the Lord's side. I'm leaning on the Lord's side. Point number 9. You are immovable. For behold, I have made you this day a fortified city and an iron pillar. I don't know about you, but when you stand on the foundation of God, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. It's a metaphor for one who supports God's divine presence. God is a good God, and he can do anything but fail. God is with me. Even when the whole world is against me, I'm going to trust in the Lord with all my heart and all my soul. I'm going to lean not to my own understanding. In all my ways, gonna acknowledge him, for he shall direct my path, which brings me to point number 10. As I get ready to go to my seat, God says, you are uncompromising. I'll let nothing separate me from the love of God. What God has shown Jeremiah in verse number 18, don't compromise your faith. Don't compromise your joy. Don't compromise your relationship, because I'll be with you even until the end of the earth. Message of compromising standards. We can't compromise for our boyfriend. Can't compromise the word of God for our girlfriend. Not gonna compromise God for my husband or my wife. I'm gonna lean. I said I'm gonna lean on his everlasting, his unchanging arms. I'm not gonna compromise who I am and who I belong to, because God believes in me, and I believe in God. The Bible says, I've never seen the righteous forsaken or seen begging bread. Amen. That's a powerful statement in the scripture. That my righteousness will continue to bring deliverance of in what any state or whatever state I happen to fall into. Because my righteousness means right standing with God. Amen. And as long as I am standing in a place that belongs to the Lord, God said he will allow no harm to come to me. Can we just look at Job's life for a minute? Job was, the Bible declares, was upright and perfect to God, in the sight of God. But yet he offered Job up unto the enemy. And I believe it's because he knew Job's righteousness would overcome his circumstances. Will God say that about you? That no matter what comes or what goes, that you will stand in the righteousness of God? Because even after Job had dealt with all those things, Jesus restored him back to who he was. And not only did he restore him, he gave him more than what he had before. What are you saying to me, Pastor? What I'm simply saying to you is no matter what happens in your life, if you're a child of God, you have to hold on to God's unchanging hand. Because God, the God, believes in you. God believes in you. God, that's powerful. To know that a God who is powerful as he is has announced to you that he believes in you. And if we would just hold on to God's unchanging hand, everything would be all right. So I'm encouraging you today that in this encounter, as you have came to God and you have given your life to him, know that God believes in you. I know in this life we encounter people, no matter what we say, no matter what we, how we live, they'll say, yeah, they faking. They don't really love God. Just keep your eye on and watch them mess up. I stopped by to tell you today that we're going to make mistakes on this side of heaven. And what's that sign we're supposed to carry? I'm a work in progress. But God believes in you. You got to stay the course. Paul says, he makes a statement, I'll let nothing separate me from the love of God. Now, Paul encountered some stuff when he got on this side of glory. He did some stuff before he got saved, but when he got on this side and began to fight the good fight, Paul encountered some stuff. But Paul said, I'll let nothing separate me from the love of God. He says, not heights, nor depths, nor things in my past, nor things that I'm going to encounter in my present, and the things in my future, I'm not going to allow them to separate me from the love of God. Because ultimately what he believed, Sister Angie, this is what Paul believed. He believed that the short time he spent on earth was not near as vital to where he was going.